what happened. Let me show you what happened. You should see this picture here of what changed the world. May 21st, 1921, Wonder Bread was released into the world. And it was really a game changer. They said that Wonder Bread would be a bread that didn't dry out very easily. It had 12 vitamins and minerals that would be able to help sustain you and make you good and strong. How many like Wonder Bread? How many still buy it? All right, two people. Okay, very good. Three. Another thing, by 1930, Wonder Bread had changed the world again because it was one of the first commercially sliced bread. At least there's nothing better than, you know, this best thing since sliced bread. Well, that's around 1930 when they started doing it by machine and selling it everywhere. So, honestly, Wonder Bread, from their perspective, they really changed the world. But here's a question for you this morning. Can bread really change your life? Can bread really change your life? Honestly, though, that is a yes and no question. Think about it this way. There may be somebody who is hungry, and they don't have anything to eat. They've not eaten for a long time. Bread can help them, right? Bread can help sustain their life. But think about somebody who has had the end of their life. If they no longer really can eat, that bread, a piece of bread, isn't going to help them. No matter the marketing, no matter how great it sounds, no matter if you put a whole bunch of loaves around them, it's not really going to help them. Here's the thing, bread can feed the bellies of the hungry or give nourishment to one lacking nourishment. But bread cannot itself sustain somebody forever. Bread cannot forever be the great lifesaver, even if it has those 12 minerals in there, even if it's sliced. But what if somebody has said to you, or comes up and says, I know a bread that can nourish you and sustain you forever. Even as foolish as that sounds, you'd at least be intrigued. You'd at least want to maybe hear their product pitch. Could you imagine being in the crowd in Jesus' day? In the crowd that you don't know what you know right now about Jesus and who he is. And Jesus says to you, I am the bread of life, and he who comes to me shall never hunger and never thirst, and he who believes in me will have eternal life. You would at least be intrigued, even though you didn't believe it. I want to go to this next portion, kind of the goal in our Sunday mornings, even though we go through different series, is to ultimately go through the book of John. Listen to what John says in John 6. Let's start in verse 22. The following day, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw that there was none other boat there, save the one where the disciples had entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that the disciples were gone away alone. And then there's a little side note, verse 23. There came other boats from Tiberias, not into the place where they did eat bread after the Lord had given thanks. When the people, therefore, saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping, or that really means they got into boats and they went after him. They came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? Or really, when did you get here? Jesus answered and said unto them, Verily I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. Then said they unto him, What shall we do that we might work the works of God? And Jesus answered unto them and said, This is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent. And they said therefore unto him, what sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said unto them, now verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread of heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. Then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father gives me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven, and not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. This is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again on that last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him will have, may have, everlasting life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Lord, I just thank you, Lord. Speak to us through your word. Show us how you are the bread of life. In Jesus' name, amen. It's been a while since we've been here in John chapter 6. But I want to remind you of what went on here in this text. What this story surrounds is kind of very interesting, what's going on. Verses 23 through 24 of this text give us a summary of what has happened at the beginning of John chapter 6. If you've not read John chapter 6 before, haven't read it in a while, I would just suggest maybe this week that you read those 21 verses before, because it's a very interesting story. We understand that Jesus had just completed feeding 5,000 men with bread and fish. Now think about this. Is it not strange or coincidental that Jesus said he was the bread of life right after feeding over 5,000 people with bread and with fish? So here's what happened. All this group of people, men and women, beyond 5,000, really, they're just counted men here in the text. But beyond that, think about that. They were all filled. They were all satisfied when Jesus miraculously fed them out of the lunch of a little boy, 5 loaves and 2 fishes. They were pumped up. They were ready to make Christ the earthly king because he fed them. He just provided a supernatural meal right in front of them. And Jesus, though, the Bible says that they were so pumped up, they were so encouraged that they were ready to make him king. That's verse 15. And Jesus is not interested in being an earthly king. So you know what Jesus did? He just left them. And he decided, I'm going to go to Capernaum, away from them. And so he sent his disciples ahead on from him. And the disciples got in the boat. They crossed the sea, and they went over the sea. And, of course, they encountered some rough seas and some rough winds. And then Jesus walked on the water to show that he was more than an earthly king, that he was the king over heaven and earth. But interesting, in verse 22, the day following, the Bible says, the people started searching for Jesus. They looked around and they said, well, the disciples' boat's not here. Jesus is not here. Jesus, where'd you go? So you know what these people did? They were so interested in what Jesus did. They went and got boats and went across the sea in order to find this man, Jesus, and ask him, why did you leave us? We were going to make you king. We were going to make you the king. Jesus, what he does in this next conversation, starting with verse 26, Jesus challenges their reasoning for seeking him. And this challenge still confronts you and it confronts me today. What Jesus is going to do to those who are questioning him is get to the heart issue of something that we all need. Now, sometimes I give you the entire summary of the sermon at one point. I only have 2 points this morning, but let me give you the main point of what's going on here. And I'll put it on the screen for you, or really Mike can put it on the screen for you. I have no control up here. The eternal craving of our souls can only be satisfied by Jesus. The eternal craving of our souls can only be satisfied by Jesus. This is exactly what he is saying in this story. So what does Jesus say? Look at verse 26. Verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, not because you saw the power of God, not because you saw who I am, but notice that phrase, but because you did eat of the loaves and fishes and you were full. I took you to the restaurant, I filled you up, and now you're seeking me to see if I can get another free meal out of you, basically is what Jesus would say in today's context. Noel would say, let me just take you to Golden Corral and get your belly full, right? At the church, we have a running joke about that. Let me give you 2 quick points from this text about why Jesus says he is the only one that can satisfy our souls. And what is it about people like in verse 26 that chase after other things? Let me show you number one, the folly of chasing after temporal food. I use that word there. The folly of chasing, the foolishness of chasing after the temporal, the earthly food. So verse 24 through 26, again, the people were so ecstatic to find Jesus because they were so overwhelmed by going and eating this meal that he provided for them. And Jesus then just turns it around in verse 26 and verse 27 and tells them what they really need to do. They need to stop chasing after the things of this earth. He says, stop chasing after the bread. Look at verse 27. Labor not for the meat which perishes, that expires, that goes away, that will not leave you satisfied, but for the meat, the things of this earth, that will lead you to everlasting life. Now, obviously, Jesus is not giving us a prohibition on eating. Praise the Lord. We want to eat. Hey, I want to eat. I'm already planning what I'm eating. Right now, looking at a picture of bread right behind my point. This is horrible. Okay, so back to what we're talking about here this morning. Jesus is, Brother Joe's already planning too. That's good. Jesus is telling us that we should do more than chasing after the perishable things in this life. He's saying that, sure, it's great to work, because what does the Bible say about it? It says, if a man will not work, he should not eat. That's what it says in the Scripture. So he's not talking about eating, really. He's not talking about working to provide for your family. That is a good and that is a godly thing, but he's trying to make a spiritual connection with the people. What they truly needed more than bread, more than food, more than really miracles, was the satisfying bread of life. There's a folly of chasing after temporal food. But what does Jesus tell us? He tells us this. You might want to write this down. Many spend their lives chasing after the temporary instead of the eternal. Many people, and you see it in our culture, you see it in our world, they spend their lives chasing. Notice that word, chasing, after the temporary instead of the eternal. What was the reason that they got into the boats and crossed the sea? Jesus fed them. But that's not why Jesus wants people to seek him. He said, verse 26, because you ate of the loaves and were filled. But then he says this in verse 27. Notice this. What's that word? Labor. Labor. Chase after. Go after. Don't go after, verse 27, the things of this life that said, this meal that I've provided for you is just temporary. Now, this is the truth of all of us before we became a Christian. And maybe even after we become Christians, we get caught up sometimes in traps in our lives, and we start with all our might chasing things that will one day expire or they will not satisfy you. Let's go through the obvious. Let's think about a couple obvious things. How about that person that they chase because of what they're trying to chase after the eternal, but not the eternal, but the temporary? They chase after things that will fill addictions instead of Jesus, who will break their addiction. I saw the saddest thing, and I really didn't even know what to do about it this week. I was at the work for FSCJ, so I'm not downtown campus a lot. And this end of the week, I went to the pastor's conference at First Baptist Church. And you know, around First Baptist and downtown, there are people who are enslaved, not everyone, but enslaved to addiction, and they're laying on the streets. I drove up to where FSCJ was, and there's, I think it was around State Street, there's a crossing street where the Ritz Theater is at. And there's a man, yeah, you see it all the time, that they're holding signs, right? The holding signs asking for money, but this one said something different. He stood on the corner and had a sign, and I just feel so bad, and it's like, I don't even know what to do. And the sign said, I need a beer. That's why we laugh, but think about this. In light of this text, this man is so addicted to alcohol that he doesn't want anything else, any other help, but for someone to help further his addiction. Many spend their lives chasing after the eternal. Think about that. How about this? People try to satisfy their loneliness with bad relationships, right? People are lonely, and they get into bad relationship, they get abused, they get neglected, and they get in all these situations because the loneliness in their life, they don't look to Jesus, they look to other things. Or how about, you want to be so popular, maybe to somebody who's young, you want to be so popular, you want to fit in, you want to be a part of the crowd, and you will go with whatever crowd that will satisfy that urge, that earthly urge of friendship and relationship. A lot of people satisfy their egos or their covetousness by chasing after money or overspending and trying to satisfy something in their lives. And Jesus says, you're chasing after the wrong thing. But how about this? Somebody who's sitting there in total boredom and they're letting their mind wander to the wrong thing. Maybe it's to something that is awful. Maybe it's to a lustful thought. Maybe it's this, that you just sit there and you let your mind wander and wander and wander, and you think about that person you have a problem with, and you're like, man, I hate that person. And you chase after this emotion of anger and malice towards somebody. John Chrysostom, who was one of the early church fathers, said this: men are nailed to the things of this life. We in this life, we chase the things of the earth so much that we are nailed to the wall of life. We as humans chase, and we chase, and we labor, and we strive for the things that do not satisfy. You don't have to raise your hand, but I would imagine everybody in here has done that. Everybody in here. Now, this is what Jesus is not saying, this: don't enjoy life. That's not what he's saying. He's not saying don't purchase things. He's not saying don't dream and daydream and make plans and don't find friends and don't find relationships. He created this earth and everything in this earth, and he called it good, but good things can get in the place of God. And instead of responding to him and chasing after him, we chase the things that he creates. That's not what he wants. let your life be about chasing the things of this earth that ultimately are harmful or sinful. Or maybe they're not harmful or sinful, they're just not going to satisfy you. We decide it is best sometimes to try to fill the emptiness, the loneliness, the desires with things of this world. There's an old hymn that says, "Until then," that's the title, it says, "The things of earth will dim and lose their value. If we recall, they're just borrowed for a while." Have you ever heard of the term rat race? Some mornings you get in there, you get on 95, you get on 295, and you enter into the rat race. That's the description of an endless, self-defeating, pointless pursuit. Maybe some of you are like, I am in a rat race right now. A pointless self-pursuit. It conjures the image of a lab rat going through a maze trying to get some cheese. This is just like our society. What our society says, chase after, chase after, chase after, chase after, and they're never satisfied. Jesus said, you must strive, you must labor. Let me say it like this, you must pursue the food in this world that doesn't perish, but that endures to eternal life. You know what this, you know how you do this? How do you do this? This takes a change of your mind. You have to focus your mind from the things of this earth to the heavenly things. More importantly, to Jesus Christ. Here's what we know. Everyone is not on this road. This is the mind of a Christian as opposed to the mind of a carnal man. And so my question is, are you pursuing what endures to eternal life in your mind and in your body and in your spirit? We'll talk more about a life of worship tonight. We'll talk about this a little bit more. Many spend their lives chasing after the temporary instead of the eternal. And also write this down. Many spend their lives ignoring the spiritual for the earthly. Think about this. There are those who chase and there are those who ignore. Many people spend their lives ignoring the spiritual for the earthly. Jesus says in verse 27, listen fully to what he says. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which will endure to everlasting, to eternal life. Now then notice what he says. This is what they entirely miss in verse 27. Which the Son of Man shall give to you, for him has God the Father sealed. Jesus says, don't chase after these temporary things, but chase after the eternal, and I will give you the eternal. And notice what happens. Jesus says that God the Father has sent the seal. When he says the word seal, it literally is the picture of a king's ring. The ring that seals and authorizes and gives the stamp of approval. Basically, he's saying God the Father has given me the stamp of approval to give eternal life. And Jesus does this not only by the signs and the miracles, he does this by his death on the cross. But notice what happens. These people ignore and miss the message, and they focus entirely on the earthly. I want you to notice two things in verse 28 to 33. They ignore the message of Christ, and they ignore the gift of Christ. Jesus said in verse 27 that he would give them the bread. He would give them what they need of eternal life. And you know what the people responded with? How do we work for it? How are we going to get it, Jesus? This is our normal inclination. How am I going to earn this? Has anybody ever given you a gift that was so good? You say, what can I pay you for? What can I do for you? And Jesus, or that person says, it's a gift. It's just a gift. That's exactly what these people's problem are. They said, oh Lord, we want this eternal life. We want this satisfying bread. How do we work for it? And Jesus said this, you want to work for it? This is what you do. Verse 29, believe on me. This is the simple message that Jesus says over and over in the scriptures. Believe in Jesus. And this, you know what the people said? You're crazy. You are crazy. I need to work for this bread. I need to have church attendance. I need to have my name on the roll. I need to pray 30 times a day. I need to be good to my
And this is exactly what Jesus says. Watch how quickly people ignore the eternal or for the earthly. They just saw Jesus miraculously provide for over 5,000 people with a small lunch, and everybody was filled with bread. And then when Jesus dares to say, you know what, I got something better than this bread that I gave you yesterday. I have eternal bread that will satisfy your soul. You know what they said? They said, Jesus, you're crazy. How are we supposed to believe you're going to give us bread? And you've got a man who just did a miraculous thing right in front of your eyes. No screens, no smoke, no mirrors. And they said, you're crazy. You better show us the signs. And I find this really funny in Jesus' ministry. When he confronts unbelieving people, they all of a sudden get spiritual. Has that ever happened to you? You try to witness to somebody you know is lost. They don't believe in Jesus. They live a life far from God. But when you tell them about Jesus, all of a sudden they're Christians. I know all about the Bible. But you know the Bible has a bunch of contradictions. You know that one little verse that I don't understand and I've never read the context. And, let me tell you about what the Bible says. Have you read the Bible, sir? No, but I know that one little line from one little verse. I'm not trying to make fun of them, but this is exactly what these people are doing. These people are religious enough to be dangerous. And be very careful. There are a lot of people who are religious enough. I say this a lot, but they know Jesus loves me. John 3:16, the Star Spangled Banner in Sweet Home, Alabama. And they think they're going to heaven. Here's the thing. They said, Jesus, and this is in verse 30 and 31. Our fathers, they ate bread given to them by Moses. And Moses was the great prophet. He provided them bread in the wilderness. So Jesus, what are you going to do? The same person says, oh, Moses. Or, oh, sir, oh, my dad was a pastor. I'm okay. My father was a deacon. My mom was a Sunday school teacher. My parents, my aunt was a church church member for 50 years. I'm good. I'm good, you know. I've got 1,000 Bibles at home. And Jesus said this. All right, you're talking about Exodus chapter 16 and Psalms chapter 105 when God fed the people bread in the wilderness. And Moses was just the distributor of it. And he said, I'm different than Moses. I'm not distributing bread. I'm the creator of bread, and I'm going to give it to you freely. And they message and the gift. They missed the person who was standing in front of them all along. That's what our sinful world does. They miss Jesus Christ, and he is standing right in front of them. This is the key to understand the problem of chasing after temporal things in this life. When we're doing that, it becomes so easy to totally miss God, even when he is in front of you. Now, this is a little side note. Our main goal as a church, as any church, is not to merely provide for people's temporal needs. There are some churches, and I praise the Lord for them, but their main goal is to help stamp out social injustice and provide physical things for people. There is nothing wrong with that, but if you never get to what Jesus is saying, you're doing a disservice. Jesus said this, if you give a cup of cold water to a person in my name, Jesus said, when you do something for somebody who's hungry, who needs money, who needs provision, you must do it in his name. There must be something eternal attached to it. That is why people come and get mad at churches, because they say, oh, you're not a biblical church because you are not providing for every little need I have. That's not the purpose of a church. The purpose of a church is biblically to worship the Lord. That's why we're here. Secondly, to see people come to Christ. Thirdly, to make sure people's needs are met. But that sometimes is rotated on a different basis. Jesus is not offered to you. And notice what the crowd said to this. Oh, yes, Jesus, give us this bread and keep it coming. It's like Jesus, if you've been to a waiter, to a restaurant, the waiter comes to your table and says, do you want bread? You're like, sweet, do I want bread? Keep it coming, buddy. Actually, bring me bread and then bring me another thing of bread. Just because I'm going to eat this thing first. This is what they're doing. The eternal craving of our souls can only be satisfied with Jesus. I want to talk a little bit more in our next sermon. I want to show you point number two, but I'm going to go into communion in here in just a moment. But number two, go to Jesus for everlasting fulfillment. We need to go to Jesus for everlasting fulfillment. Notice what he says in verse 35. I am the bread of life. This statement is one of the first of the seven I am statements in the book of John. John's whole purpose is to show that Jesus is in fact God. He says, I am the same designation God the Father used in the Old Testament. What does Jesus say about himself? Why should we go to Jesus for everlasting fulfillment? Well, verse 33 tells us Jesus is the true bread. You ever walk down the bread aisle in Walmart, in the grocery store? There's a lot of bread for sale. There's a lot of bread for sale. This is what the world thinks about religion, about Jesus. Jesus is one loaf out of many loaves down the bread aisle. And Jesus says this, all these other breads are counterfeit breads. They won't satisfy you. Buddhism won't satisfy you. Meditation won't satisfy you. Addiction won't satisfy you. He says, I am the true bread, verse 33. He says this, I will satisfy your soul, verse 35. You will not hunger or thirst again. This is talking about the spiritual when you come to me. What did Jesus say? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled. Are you hungry this morning for not just bread, but are you hungry for Jesus? Are you hungry and thirsty for righteousness? Jesus says, I will fill you. Here's what Jesus will also do. He will receive you and keep you. Verse 37 and verse 39. If you come to me, he said, I'll give you the bread and I will not cast you away. You might say this. I've done too many bad things in my life for Jesus to come to me. He says, I will in no wise, I in no way will cast you out. Why? Because Jesus, the rest of the passage, will do the will of God. He will save anyone who looks upon the Son. He will secure them forever, and he will give them everlasting life. Maybe you are mourning the loss of a loved one, and they were a Christian. He said this, I will never let them die. If you have a Christian who has died in the faith, he said, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to raise them up on the final day. He says, they've not lost. They are not lost. This is the gospel. That Jesus came and he lived in your place. He died in your place and he rose for you. How beautiful is it that Jesus is the bread of life? Wonder Bread said that they had the 12 minerals and vitamins that would keep you sustained in your life. Guess what? That's not going to really happen. Jesus is the only one who will satisfy your soul. Now, we're going to get ready to take part of communion. And I'm going to do it a little bit differently.